Hi, this is Professor Kleitz. Continuing in section 13.7, let's look at example 13.2, and let's draw the circuit connections and timing waveforms for a recirculating shift right register. We're going to use the 74194. So the recirculation connection is going to be at Q3, since shifting right means going from 0 to 1 to 2 to 3. When 3, rather than lose its data, you're going to connect it back into the DSR. Now we're going to initially parallel load a 1101, where this one over the D3 is going to be the most significant bit. So the waveforms are going to be set up. First of all, the cues will be undetermined until the first clock edge comes along. At the first clock edge, you look at S0, S1, you see a high. That's a parallel load. That's why the Q0 through Q3 got loaded with a 1011, same as what we had on these D lines. After that, we're going to be in the shift right mode, and shifting right means that 0 is going to go to 1, 1 is going to go to 2, 3 is going to go back around into the 0. So here we go. At this clock edge right here, S0, S1 is in the shift right mode. This 1 goes to here. This 0 goes to here. This 1 goes to here. And this 1 comes all the way back around into Q0 right there. And so on. If you look at these waveforms, they are in a pattern of shifting to the right. So in figure 13.6, we're going to see how multi-sim produces a simulation. It's a good way to see the operation of the 194, and we're going to set this up for various operations, and we'll get these operations by changing the S0, S1 lines by throwing these two switches. So here's the multi-sim simulation for figure 13-16. And notice that the A, B, C, D, which are the D0 through D3 lines, are hardwired to a 1, low, low, low. The shift left receives its value from QA. The shift right receives its value from QD. So this is the recirculation. If you think about QD being on the right hand side, as you're pumping to the right, shifting to the right, when this data value is going to disappear, it's pushed back in to the data shift right, and it continues through in the path. Now the clock is just buzzing along, continuously clocking. We've got a clear push button down here, and then we've got the mode control 1 and 0 here and here. So now if we double click on the 4-channel oscilloscope, and let's set it somewhere where we can see it, and press the simulate button, we'll see that all four lines are low, 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 and just to be double sure, I'll press the C key, and it's definitely a reset. Now to do the parallel load, remember when I do parallel load, this clock is buzzing along, by the way, and when we do a parallel load, well, first of all, when I say the clock is buzzing along, let's double click on that and see. Yeah, that's a 10K hertz clock voltage. So when I press the 1 and the 0 keys, I just did a parallel load of the 1000, and look at, there it is, it's a high, low, low, low. So that did work. Now if I go into the shift mode, and we'll shift right by pressing the 1 key, the data that was in there is now shifting to the right, and you'll see that the A goes to the B, the B goes to the C goes to the D, and so on. And then I can reverse these by pressing the 01, and now it's shifting the opposite way, where the D goes to the C goes to the B, and the B goes to the A. So you should try this on your own to help solidify your knowledge of the 74194. So another valuable feature available in some shift registers, and as far as that goes, any kind of a register type integrated circuit is called the three-state outputs. The term three-state or tri-state is derived from the fact that the output can have one of three levels. It could either be high or low, but then it's got the third condition called float. The symbol is going to be shown in figure 13.17. So there's many different variations of this symbol, but in this case we just have a straight buffer, and whatever's on the input is trying to go through the output, but it's not allowed to go through unless the OE line is low. So this is an active low output enable. In a function table, it looks like this. So as long as OE is low, the 1 goes through to the 1, and the 0 goes through as a 0. But as soon as OE goes high, the outputs are forced into the float condition. Now, float condition just means that the internal switch is in the open position, so the output is in the high impedance state, meaning float, which means if you look back in, this line is connected to nothing and it just floats. It's not high nor low. This is useful when you have several registers connected to the same data bus and you only want one register to be sending data to the data bus at a time. You would put all the registers in their float condition except for the one that you want activated. We'll see this operation a lot more in later chapters and then in any kind of a microcontroller course that you may take in the future. So to illustrate the three-state output capability, let's look at the 74395. This has parallel input. Here's your parallel input, D0 through D3. It's got a parallel enable, which means that while that's high, you have to apply a negative clock edge to get the data to go through to the queues. The queues will be in their float condition unless not OE, pin 9, is driven low. So if you put a low here, then you get to see the queues, otherwise they're floating. It has an active low master reset also. We also have the complement of the last bit, the Q3 bit. Let's take a look at this output floating condition by looking at the circuit diagram, internal circuit diagram. So this shows how we get the floats on the Q0 through Q3 because they all have three-state buffers on them. This diagram looks a little bit different. We have a bubble here to complement the not Q back to its original state, to a Q state. So Q goes on through if we have a high. There's no bubble on the control line, so we need a high here. To get a high here, we need a low on the not OE. So a low not OE activates all four buffers to dump their information off to the output Q0 through Q3. And again, here's the not Q3 off the final output. And this is called not Q3 because you would have thought that was a regular Q, but it got inverted on the S inputs on all of these. So this got the actual value does get flipped over. And of course, up here you can see how the parallel enable works. If you have a high here, it gets turned into a low, which is really a high over on this side, and that's a strobe input on an AND gate, so the D's don't go through unless you have a high on the other leg. So here's your parallel enable. So to see how this works, let's look at example 13-3, which is an actual circuit using this chip. So in example 13.3, we're going to sketch a circuit connection for a two-register system that alternately feeds one register, then the other, into a 4-bit receiving device. Upon power-up, we want to load the first register with the number 7 and the second register with the 1101, which is a hexadecimal letter D. Now, as I said before, the whole purpose of the three-state outputs is that if you have a receiving device that's receiving data from two different registers, you would have a conflict if both registers were activated at the same time. So the OE pin right here and right here is only allowed to be active on one or the other. So when this clock oscillator on this JK flip-flop set up as a toggle, 1-1 is a toggle, right? You're going to have a 1-0, and then it's going to flip 0-1, and then a 1-0-0-1. So one of these is activated while the other one's not, and so on, back and forth. So how do we get the initial values into these 4-bit registers? Well, that's done with a power-up reset, which goes through a Schmidt. Remember, this part will go low then high on the cap, which produces a high then low on the output of the Schmidt. This high then low produces the clock edge for both of the clock inputs of the registers. So whatever's on the D lines at power up, gets pushed into the particular register in question. So this one's going to receive the 7, this one's going to receive the number D, the hex number D, letter D I should say. Then after that, as this clock oscillator is buzzing along, high, low, high, low, the Q in that Q just flips back and forth, 1001, 1001, and like I said before, first you'll activate this, and then you'll activate this register, and then back and forth, and that's solving the problem that I described for this example. So that completes section 13.7. Next, 13.8, we'll be looking at some system design applications using shift registers.